back in Port Maurelle again. Anyone will think we like this bay. No, it's hard not to. Sunset's not there. The only problem is I'm disturbing the peace tonight. Filling bottles. It's about done.
Mariner's cave, and we'll probably have a dive right here too through what's called the gap right here between that island there and Shark Tooth. And for now, we're just going down to Mariner's cave.
So Mariner's Cave is 1 to 3 meters underwater, and you have to swim about 3 meters underwater to be able to come up inside of the cave. It can be done as a snorkel, but most of us here are doing it as a dive. There's a second entrance that's down quite low, so yeah, it would certainly have to be a scuba dive, that one. There's a bit of a tale to Mariner's Cave and how it's named, and I'll read it here. So Mariner, or William Mariner, was a 14-year-old clerk aboard an English privateer vessel called the Port Orfran Prince, the crew of which were massacred by the Tongans in the Hapai Island group in 1806. Mariner was spared and was virtually adopted by King Finno. Anyway, the story goes that in former times there was a tyrannical leader who mistreated his subjects. One of his chiefs, hoping to free the people of the tyranny, planned a rebellion, but he was caught and condemned to be drowned at sea with, as they tended to do in those days, all his family and relations. A young chief was secretly in love with one of the condemned man's daughters, a maiden who he would otherwise have had no access. She was promised to someone of higher rank. So, thinking quickly, he hurried to her abode, declared himself, and explained the situation and her options, which were none. Fortuitously, she had secretly been smitten with him, and putting her trust in her saviour, allowed him to spirit her away in his canoe and hide her in his cave. the young chief kept her stashed for 2 or 3 months, bringing food, water, and bedding as he could, until he was able to arrange to be sent on an expedition to Fiji. On his way out from Vavau, he stopped his canoes, left his men perplexed as he dived into the water and disappeared, only to return with his mate in fear. And off they sailed to Fiji, where they lived happily, of course, until the tyrant was dead. On his learning of this tale, Mariner was skeptical about her ability to survive in the cave, which has no evident source of fresh air, and took it upon himself to find an opening. Although he was not successful, it was later discovered that there was a fissure that only gets exposed at low tide. It was high tide when Mariner looked, which does allow the cave to breathe. This is what's called shark tooth. Not quite sure why it's called shark tooth. Even with an aerial view, it doesn't really look like a shark tooth, but I suppose it could. It's cave. It's got a cave here, and it's quite a deep cave, which actually has a air pocket in there as well, which you'll see shortly. But yeah, so this feels a pretty stunning, deep, long cave. Thank you.
bottom, this bottom part. Okay. So a little bit of a twist.
Okay. To the, yeah, righty-righty-tighty. Okay.
Yeah, righty-tighty, loosey-lefty, whatever. Not a very good flashlight. Yeah, it's better than not having one, though.
Okay, what is it?
Oh, because it's
dying.
No, it has a mode for that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Tiniest starfish I've ever seen. This is a nudie branch, extremely rare. They're a very small slug, sea slug, that come in all sorts of shapes and colours. I get too excited and get the camera too close, so nothing's in focus, unfortunately. Noise is Jason trying to get my attention by hitting his knife on his dive bottle. We'll be right back.
This is another first. I don't know what it is, but when you rub it with your finger, it looks like a mirror. So this is called floating the chain. So what we do is we drop the anchor to the bottom, put the first float on, and then let out another 10 metres, another float, another 10 metres, another float, depending on how much chain you're putting out. See how the floats aren't actually on the surface, and the chain is up at the bottom, so should we swing around, it won't catch on all those little bits of reef down there. So it works really well. Easy to deploy, easy to retrieve. It's good. Saves the bottom.
And this is the sort of habitat that we're trying to preserve. Imagine getting your chain wrapped around this and destroying it all. This was pretty close to the boat too, this is just off to the side of it.
This is the first one of these things I've seen. that's actually eating. All the ones I've seen are dormant, but this thing looks like it's eating sand and obviously full of feeding the sand.
Grillo heading off to Fiji, parting the vow. Hopefully we get to see them again in Fiji, and if not New Zealand, and if not, well, I'll score myself a compressor hose. Score. Oh, can I say goodbye? See ya, gonna miss ya. That wind.